Good afternoon, I'm Barb, I'm Grant's wife, Dorothy's daughter-in-law, and I want to thank you for coming today to support us and to pay tribute to Dorothy.
This could be kind of informal, we just wanted some time to socialize with all of you and say some remarks about her. First, I'm going to just kind of talk about Dorothy's early life and parts of it some of you know and some of it you don't know. And then Dawn's going to sing a little song for us that Grant picked out. And afterwards, we'll have some time for other remembrances from folks that are here. So I wanted to talk about who else was here today. Of course, my husband, Grant, Dorothy's son, and his daughter, Alicia, and Dorothy's son, Kent, and his wife, Cheryl. Dorothy's three granddaughters are here, Janelle, Dawn, and Alicia. Also, Janelle and Dawn's mother and her husband, Chris, back here, yeah, and Marv, her husband. Dorothy's great-grandchildren, Christopher, there? No, that's Drake. Christopher. Drake, Peyton, there, and Jocelyn.
Back here.
Right there.
Jacob.
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 Okay, thank you. There's his name. Okay. Also, a nephew on Tom's side, Jack, and his wife, Julie. There. And Tom's second cousins, Betty Boss, Ralph Boss, and Ralph's wife, Karen. And Dorothy's honorary daughter, but she never had, Teresa Williams. There you are. Okay. Well, our Dorothy was quite the gal. She was born August 4th, 1923, in Keystone, Iowa. Soon after, the family moved to the Belle Plaine area, where she grew up on the family farm. When I visit Dorothy, she told me some stories, and I'd like to share some of those stories with you today. She said that they didn't have electricity in the house until she was about 13. When her father attended Farm Bureau meetings, she got to go with her mother and her brother and sister to the movies, which then only cost 10 cents. Her first movie was Frankenstein. She said it just scared the heck out of her. She also enjoyed the Buster Keaton movies, but her favorite movies were the ones with Clark Gable in them, so we know why. Dorothy attended Belle Plaine High School, where she met at the tender age of 14 her future husband, Tom Miller. Dorothy wasn't a big fan of the farm life, so after graduating from high school at the age of 16, she took off for the big city of Cedar Rapids, and she attended the St. Luke's Nursing School. She had to wait a year before she could begin the nursing school, and she had to work as an aide for a year because she was still too young. After becoming a nurse, Dorothy and three other nursing grads took off for an adventure to Texas. But while there, one of the women learned that her husband was missing in action. And so she returned home. And shortly after that, the other girls all went home as well, and all of them joined the Army. Dorothy was stationed at O'Reilly General Hospital in Missouri. And she and Tom kept in touch. So sometime after she graduated, after she served in the Army, and we think she was working in Springfield, Illinois at that time, that one day Tom said he just couldn't pass up the chance to live forever with Dorothy. So he got on a plane and he flew out to Chicago, and the very next day on her birthday, they got married. Soon after that, they moved to Cedar Rapids, where she lived for the next 60 years. And so in November 2011, she moved to the Mayflower Homes in Bunnell. And as you probably know, Dorothy raised three boys, Craig, Grant, and Kent. And Tom once told me that they gave the boys one syllable names so that they wouldn't be given nicknames. Now I have one son and I thought, wow, raising three, that would be a handful. Grant remembers that when he had a paper route, when it would be just terribly cold here, and on the very coldest days, Dorothy would get up at 4:30 in the morning and drive him around to help deliver those papers. Dorothy's husband worked for the railroad,
So the family traveled by train fairly often, and they visited Chicago several times, and they took the train across country to visit Tom's brother in California. In the 1980s, Dorothy's eyesight began to fail, so she had to give up her career in nursing. But her eyesight rarely got in the way of other things that she wanted to do. She and Tom took many trips to Europe. For a while, it was every year. And eventually, they visited 13 countries. They also drove cross-country several times, or flew, to visit Grant and Kent in California, and Tom's brother in California. I think what I remember the most about Dorothy is how well she got along with the very little sight that she had. And she remained interested in everything. I remember visiting her for the first time, and she wanted to see my engagement ring. So she pulled out the magnifying glass and she took a real close look at it. It was just part of Dorothy, that she just wanted to still know everything that was going on and see it as best she could. She told me that she could see out the corner of her eye, kind of a chopped up view of the world, but that let her get around. Due to Tom's health, they couldn't come to our wedding in 2007, but the very next year, with the help of her great-grandson, Christopher, she flew out to see us, and then she went out to Spokane all by herself. When we would visit and go out to places she had never been to before, she would step up on the curb and know exactly where to go in these new places. And that was because of the limited vision she had, but her ability to put it together into some picture and get around in the world. We were really concerned about her when she moved to the Mayflower. She had to learn a whole new place, a whole room and a building and get around, but she did. She managed these tunnels and her way to dinner every evening, and she did a great job. I don't think anyone there ever quit worrying about her. And it was wonderful this morning. We met with people there that knew and loved her and just shared what a wonderful human being she was. And I think she was that to all of us. So I'm going to stop at that and have Don take over with her song.